Hello viewers, welcome to my channel IIT JEE Olympiads and AP Physics with Ambarish. And in today's video I have brought in very important concept of 3D rotation about a point. This is a precursor to JEE Advanced 2016 problem where two disks are rolling on a floor. So it turns out that we need to understand a lot of 3D rotation theory in order to properly analyze that problem, because many books they have just analyzed the problem in a very haphazard manner without giving much thought to the underlying theory. And very ad hoc analysis is available, and many books are giving contradictory answers. So to settle the controversy, I thought that I should get into the depth of the 3D rotation theory that's required for doing that problem. So in that series I brought a problem, and I'll be telling you the concept, and then I'll be solving this problem based on the concept that we learned in the first part of the video. Okay, so what's the problem statement? A thin disk of mass capital M and radius capital R rolls without slipping on a horizontal surface as shown, such that the angular velocity of revolution is capital omega. Okay, so this is revolving, and of course along with revolving, if it's not slipping, then it will also be spinning about its own axis, and the axis itself is revolving. Okay, so the revolution omega is given, that is capital omega vector. This is the omega of the revolution. We don't know the spinning omega, and we don't know the omega of the rigid body. So those are the things that we need to find out. Okay, so angular velocity of revolution is capital omega vector. Find part A, the angular velocity of the disk, omega vector. Okay, part B, angular velocity of spinning, omega s, and angular acceleration of the disk. So why do we call it rotation about a point? Because if you see, if this disk, you see, if it is spinning only, so if it is spinning, then this point will be at rest. If it is just spinning with its axis in just one place, this point will be at rest. And suppose it is not spinning, it is only revolving, still this point is going to be at rest. So in any case, there is, even though the disk as a whole is revolving without slipping, it's rotating also and it's revolving also, but there's one point on the axis of this spinning axis of the disk which is always at rest. So in that sense, we can say that this is rotation about a point. And this type of problem, this theme is seen in many problems, whether it be a rolling cone or a rolling disc as I've shown, or a rolling lollipop or a spinning top. Many times we come across this type of a theme where there's a 3D rotation happening about a point. There is one point on the rigid body or its rigid extension which is always at rest. Even suppose instead of a disc it were a rolling coin, still it is possible that on the spinning axis of the rolling coin, normal to the coin, there is one point which is not moving at all. It could be an imaginary point on the imagined extension of the coin, or it could be a real point on the extension of the coin. Okay, so this is the point about which we say 3D rotation is happening, and we are interested in finding out, given capital omega vector, we are interested in finding out omega vector and omega s vector. All right, and let's say this angle theta is known. So if you want, you can give it some thought and then look into the detailed theory that I'm going to explain. All right, so I hope you've understood the problem. Now let's try to analyze this problem in detail. Now one thing is clear, based on the given geometry, this angle is going to be 45 degree, right? Because this radius is also r and this is also r, so that means what? This angle is going to be 45 degree. Okay, so keep that in mind while solving this particular problem. Before that, I'll look into the general theory. Okay, now let's look at the theory behind this rotation about a point. Okay, so now let's say, and now I've shown a side view in which the disk is appearing like a rectangle, and let's say there is some point P on the disk. Okay, and we'll try to think about the velocity of this point P, which is there on the rolling disk. Okay, so now what can I write for the velocity of point P? So suppose the disk were to spin only, there were no revolution omega, only its axis were spinning, I mean the disk were spinning about its axis and the axis were stationary, then what will be the velocity of point P? You know that the point P will be going in a circle about the center of the disk. So the speed of point P is going to be nothing but omega s times this orange radius. Okay, this orangish line dotted that is there. So omega into this distance will be the speed of P. And vectorially, if I want, I can write it as omega spin cross this orangish vector. Okay, but then my claim is that instead of taking omega s cross this orangish vector, I can also take omega s cross this red vector r. Why is that? Because you know that this r vector can be resolved into two components. One is along this green line,
and the other perpendicular to the green line. And when you take the cross product of omega spin with r vector, so that you can say divide that into omega s cross r parallel plus omega s cross r perpendicular, okay. And omega s cross r parallel, if you take, you know that if two vectors are parallel, their cross product anyway goes to zero, okay. So I can as well write the speed of point P due to spinning alone as omega s cross this vector r, okay. So that's if the point P were, I mean, if the disk were only spinning, this is the speed that point P will get. And this we can also say that in the revolving frame, suppose I take a frame which is revolving with capital omega. So in that frame, if I'm constantly revolving, let's say I'm always keeping my face towards the center of the disk and I'm somewhere on this axis. So in that frame, I will not be able to see any revolution of the disk. I'll be only able to see omega, okay. So from that frame, I can say that the speed of point P is nothing but omega spin cross r, okay. But then what about the ground frame? Now, since the revolving frame, if you see in the revolving frame, this point P, suppose this disk were not spinning, suppose it was only revolving, then also this point P will have some velocity, okay. So suppose I consider the speed of point P due to revolution alone, okay. So in revolving frame, there will be some point which will appear to be at rest if the disk were only sliding. Revolving and no spinning, then this point will have some velocity. And what will that velocity be? That will be capital omega into this pink distance, right? Which can also be written as capital omega vector cross this pink vector. But then once again, capital omega cross this pink vector can always be written as capital omega cross this red vector. Why? Because again, this red vector can be resolved into this pink vector and the vertical vector. And you know that the cross product with the vertical vector is going to be zero. So omega cross this pink vector is as good as omega cross vector r, the red vector. Okay. So that's what I've written. Due to revolution alone, the point P would have speed omega P Vp due to the omega is capital omega cross r. Okay. So if the disk were sliding without spinning, then this point will have this much speed, okay. And on top of that, along with sliding, suppose it is also spinning, then we need to add this extra speed that is visible from the revolving frame, okay. So we can say that speed of this point P, speed of the revolving frame point as seen from ground frame, plus speed relative to the revolving frame, okay. So total speed of P will be summation of these two, okay. So we can say that by superposition, speed of point P is nothing but Vp due to spinning alone plus Vp due to revolution alone. That is, if you see, this is omega s cross r, this is capital omega cross r, where r is this vector. So you can take cross r common and you can say that speed of point P is nothing but omega spin plus omega revolution cross r, okay. So this is one way of arriving at the speed of point P, okay. Now, notice carefully that this point O is always at rest. And also there will be some point of the disk which will be on the ground, which is also at instantaneous velocity zero. So A is at rest and O is at rest. That means what? And you can imagine this disk to be part of some cone which is rolling. Okay. So it's just part of a rolling cone. You can imagine it to be part of rolling cone, and OA will be the slant height of that cone, right? And all the points on along OA, they will be at rest because it's part of somewhat like part of a rolling cone. That means what? OA, since all the points on OA are at rest, or right now in the current problem, O is at rest and A is at rest, that means what? OA is the instantaneous axis of rotation of this disk, okay? And if the instantaneous axis is OA, then what is the distance, what is the speed of point P? We can say it's nothing but the angular velocity times the perpendicular distance, okay? So let's say this angular velocity is omega, that is the angular velocity of the rigid body. So velocity of P is this omega times this turquoise line that you're saying, this turquoise vector, okay, omega cross this turquoise vector. But once again, can I write, instead of omega cross turquoise vector, can I write this omega cross this red vector? Can I write that? Yes, of course. Why? Because once again, if you see this red vector component, the vertical component is this turquoise line, and this horizontal component which is parallel to this omega vector. So cross it with the parallel component, that goes to zero, and only the perpendicular cross will be left, okay. So that means what? I can also write the speed of point P, or rather velocity of point P, is nothing but this omega vector cross this r vector. Actually, don't get confused by this blue arrow. This omega vector is actually pointing towards negative x-axis, okay. because if you curl your fingers along this direction, your thumb will be pointing in the negative x direction. Okay, so that's why. So please keep in mind, this arrow is for the x axis, positive x axis. Omega vector is towards the negative x axis. Okay, so omega cross r is again the velocity of point P. So this is another way of writing the velocity of point P. So using instantaneous axis, I can write Vp as omega cross r. Now you see these two equations. This is the equation where we say Vp is omega s plus omega of revolution cross r, and here it is omega of the rigid body cross r. So what can you conclude from these two equations? It is the same point P which is described in two different ways. That means what? I can say that omega of the rigid body is nothing but omega of spin and plus omega of revolution. Okay, please note, if the rigid body is revolving into the slide, let us say it is going inwards, then this omega s vector is going to point out like this. Okay, omega s vector is going to point out like this, and capital omega vector is along the plus j cap direction. And you can see that if you take the vector sum of these two, so omega s vector has a horizontal component and a vertical component. So that means what? Since net omega of the rigid body is along the horizontal axis only, that means what? Omega s vertical component should exactly cancel the omega of the revolution. Okay, that's why the two omega vectors will add up to the omega of the rigid body. Okay, so this is a very important relation. We can say that it's as if the rigid body, not as if, exactly what is happening, the angular velocity of rigid body is nothing but the simple sum of omega of vector sum of the spinning omega plus the revolution omega. That's the net omega of the rigid body. So I hope that's clear. And once this is clear, it's very easy to solve the problem that I stated. So now using this result in the problem, let's see how we can proceed. So now in our problem, this angle was given as 45 degree. Okay. And let's say I consider a point P at the center of the disk. So now I can calculate the speed of this point P in two different ways. Either, now you know that because of spinning, this point is not going to have any velocity because it's at the center of the disk. So because of spinning alone, point P has got absolutely no speed. So whatever velocity point P has in the ground frame, that's due to the revolution alone, because this axis itself is revolving around the y-axis. Okay. The axis of the disk is revolving around the y-axis. So what's the speed of point P? I can say this is r, and this red line must be equal to r cos 45 degree, and this is rotating with revolving with capital omega. So the speed of point P because of this revolution becomes simply capital omega into r cos 45 degree. Okay, so capital omega into r cos 45 degree is this speed. And then about the instantaneous axis, let's say the speed is this small omega vector. The angular velocity is the small omega vector, which is obviously in the minus I cap direction. If you think of the revolution in a proper manner, the disk is revolving into the slide, not coming out of the slide. So this omega vector, if you curl your fingers properly, then you'll see that it's in the minus I cap direction. Okay, so this omega vector into this orange distance, you can say, so omega into this orange distance should also be the speed of point P, because this is the instantaneous axis. Okay, so that's what I've written. So this distance is r sine 45 degree. Okay, so small omega into capital R sine 45 degree is also the speed of point P, and this straight away gives the relation between capital omega and small omega. What's the relation? Very simple, because the angle is chosen in such a manner that small omega is coming out to be equal to capital omega. Okay, so now I have found the angular velocity in terms of the revolution. So this is the total angular velocity of the rigid body that I found in terms of the revolution omega. Okay, and vectorially I can write down omega vector is nothing but minus magnitude of this omega, capital omega, times I cap. Why minus sign? You can see that if the disk is spinning into the slide, this omega vector has to be based on curling of your fingers, has to be in the minus I cap direction. Okay, so that's the answer to one of the parts where the angular velocity of the rigid body was to be found. Okay, now what about the angular velocity of the spin? So recall the equation from the previous slide. You know that the total angular velocity vector was nothing but the spinning omega vector plus the revolution omega vector. Okay, and based on this, we can straight away rearrange this equation to get the spinning omega vector. So what is the omega vector for spinning? That is nothing but this omega minus the capital omega vector, which is the revolution omega vector. Okay, and you can now subtract it. So this, you know that is in the j cap direction. So this was in the minus I cap direction. So this is minus omega I cap, and this is your capital omega j cap. You subtract the two and you get omega spin is minus capital omega I cap and minus capital omega j cap. And if to visualize, you can see that this vector is pointing somewhere in the third quadrant like that. Okay, And you can see that one of the components of omega spin is the vertical component, which is exactly cancelling the revolution omega vector. And that's why the net omega vector is along the x-axis, and the minus I cap component is left, and JJ component cancels out. Okay. And the magnitude of omega s is nothing but capital omega root 2. So this is the answer to the part B of the question. All right. Now, one more thing that was asked was the angular acceleration of the disk. So what's the definition of angular acceleration? The definition of angular acceleration is the rate of change of angular velocity of the rigid body. So here, what is the angular velocity of the rigid body? This omega vector, okay? The one that is along the minus I cap direction. This omega vector is the angular velocity vector, and obviously as the disk rolls, you know that the instantaneous axis will keep on shifting. And what will be the rate of rotation of the instantaneous axis? That will be same as the revolution omega of the disk, right? So based on that, we'll be able to find out the alpha. Let's see on the next slide, how do we find the alpha, okay? So now imagine, try seeing this disk from the top view. If you see from the top view, you will see that omega vector initially is in this direction, and after a time dt, the revolution axis, this x axis itself has rotated through an angle capital omega into d theta. Capital omega into dt in dt time. So in the projection, you can see that initially from the top view, this omega of the rigid body is in this direction, and after some time dt, this omega vector has got revolved through some angle, let's say d theta, and this d theta will be exactly equal to capital omega dt, because the axis is revolving with capital omega, okay? So this is how things look in the top view, okay? So this is omega, and after some time this is the omega. So what is the change in omega vector? So you can see that this straight line is almost, you can say that this arc length will be almost equal to the straight line length, the way we derive the centripetal acceleration for circular motion. Somewhat similar diagram we have got here in terms of omega vector, okay? So change in omega vector is nothing but omega into d theta. This is the initial omega vector, and this is the omega vector after time dt, okay? So the change in omega vector is omega into d theta, where d theta is omega into dt. So I can just divide the whole thing by dt to get the acceleration vector, okay? So we can say that d omega vector by dt is omega into d theta over dt. You divide this by dt, okay? And what is this direction? You see, this direction is the I cap direction, okay? This is a little small problem in this, actually. This diagram should have been the other way around. This some let me try to use a pen. Actually, there's some error. Just take the mirror image of this diagram. This diagram would look like this initial omega and the final omega. Anyway, you'll be able to understand this, and there'll be this. This will be the d theta. Okay. So because omega vector is in this direction, okay, so this is the initial omega vector, and then after dt time, this omega vector will be like this, okay? So try to imagine a mirror image of this, okay? So then d omega by dt is omega into d theta by dt, and that comes out to be actually it should come out to be in the plus k cap direction, because I've made some error. Instead of showing in the minus I cap direction, I've shown it in plus I cap. Accordingly, both things will change, and the change vector will come out to be in plus k cap. This direction must be minus k cap. Why? Because from the top view, you see this y axis, this is x axis, and it's turning inside if omega were to the right hand side. But omega is to the left hand side. So if this vector turns, so it comes this way, and this the change vector will come in the plus k cap direction. So excuse me for that error in the slide, okay? But I hope I've been able to explain what's the exact situation. And this direction is minus k cap, and in the mirror image, this should be equal to plus k cap, okay? So d omega by dt is the acceleration vector, which is omega d theta by dt, and there'll be a plus k cap over here, okay? If you take the mirror image diagram of this, okay? So that gives us the angular acceleration vector, and there will be a plus over here, and there will be a plus over here, okay? So that's what we get for the angular acceleration of the disk, all right? And I hope that this video was useful. You did understand the 3D rotation about the point. And if you did find this video useful, you like this video, please do subscribe to my channel if you're not already subscribed, and share this video as much as possible with the students who might benefit from this, students preparing for Olympiads or ITJ Advanced, and do give it a thumbs up. Thanks a lot for watching this video. And that's all for this video. See you in the next one.